Tonight, we begin the seventh season of the Bendorf Bench, and they say it wouldn't last. Are you ready for some high school football? We're ready, and we've got the guys here to tell you all about it. The Bendorf Bench begins right now. Matt Fetters, and welcome to the Bendorf Bench. This is the program all about high school football here in Northern Virginia, and of course featuring the Bendorf brothers, Mark Bendorf, head coach of the Robinson Rams, and Pete Bendorf, former head coach of the Oakland Cougars, now activities director at Madison High School. Gentlemen, welcome back for another season.
Thanks, Matt.
All right, we got a lot to talk about. We're going to talk about 9 or 10 different games. We'll get to that in just a second, but let's take a second just kind of talk about what has transpired since last season ended. Pete, you go from Oakton High School to Madison High School. You guys go out kind of almost on top, runners-up state championship game. You move on to Madison to be the activities director. Kind of tell us about why you made that move.
Well, actually, it was something that happened very quickly. Shortly after the state championship game, I was approached about the director of student activities job at Madison, and Mark Merrill, who's the principal there, who I've known, actually through athletics and youth football for 30 years. I sat down and talked to him about the job, and it just was an opportunity that presented itself and something that I had been working towards for quite some time. And, you know, I don't know that I was ready to step away from coaching, but sometimes when you get opportunities like that, you have to take them. And it's a new challenge. It's been kind of interesting for me. My whole life, since I was 8 years old, August rolled around, it was time to get ready and play football, and this was the first August that it wasn't that way. I kind of was joking the other day and said, you know, I was used to creating the fires, now my job is to put the fires out. But it's been a nice challenge, and definitely some new things for me. It's changed my focus quite a bit, but you know, football is my passion, and I'm sure it always will be.
And Mark, I'm sure you had some words of wisdom for him, like let the football coach do whatever he wants.
Oh no, absolutely not. You know, I realize he's just chasing the buck now. It's he won the big poker pot and got up from the table and left. But no, I'm happy for
think
him.
Think about He'll, it that way.
You know, I'm sure Oakland's loss is Madison's gain.
So. As you said, first of all, in a long time, you haven't been directly involved with football. What's been the toughest part for you?
Well, the most difficult part, and there's a couple of things, and I'm sure Friday night will be another challenge, but the camaraderie with coaches, really, really miss that. It's a little different being the administrator. You can't sit in there and yuck it up with them and that kind of thing. And just the time that you spend on the field, especially in battle. The other part is with kids. I don't have direct contact with them on a daily basis, and that's been difficult for me. I always look forward to the first day of practice when you get that raw group, and you kind of, especially through those first couple of weeks of August where you make so much progress. So I've missed that. And the thing I know that I'm going to miss is the competitiveness. Mark and I have talked a little bit about that. It's just, you know, that you build and you focus all your attention into that Friday night, and you get immediate feedback. Good or bad, you get immediate feedback. In this job, I don't get that. Everything's long-term, and you're looking at upgrading the program from top to bottom. That's, you know, everything that's involved. And hopefully it turns out to be a great experience for the students.
Yeah. Speaking of missing things, Mark, you guys, your offseason has been a little concentration on you. You graduated a lot of players. I'm sure you're going to miss that kind of leadership and those kids that moved on. And your focus now is on bringing up the guys that were behind them. Tell us a little bit about what that's like.
Yeah, the loss of experienced players, not just last year, but really over the last 2 years. Of course, with just to name a few, Blake Schubert, who was a four-year starter at linebackers at Villanova, two-time All-State. Adam Fasnacht was a player of the year twice, three-time All-State. And Chase Anastasia went to Notre Dame, was a big part of our team. And you know, Mike Emo the year before. So to say the least, you know, we have some holes to fill. But we really preach with our team and our players the responsibility for when the torch is passed to them to carry on the tradition. And I've been real proud of this group, the way they've worked in the off season. You know, they 11-1 last year, but that one at the end really left a bad taste in their mouth and, you know, focused them for the off season.
It's I mean, they've always good taste in my mouth, though. Yeah.
So, you know, we have a challenge.
So when you're facing a challenge like this, or is the time leading up to these first games, do you spend more time teaching than you normally would if you've got younger kids coming up, or is that always a priority?
We made a decision as a coaching staff prior to the start of season in July that we were going to be much more deliberate with our installation, meaning we were going to go slower with our implementation of plays and formations and defenses to make certain that the group had a good handle on what we were doing before we moved on. So consequently, you know, here we are going into a first game on Friday in 2 days, and you know, I was looking at what we have installed, and we're not as far along as where we normally are, but you know, I've been pretty happy with both our scrimmages. We looked okay, and you know, maybe we'll be a little bit better on our execution because we went slower.
Pete, I'm sure you've had similar circumstances when you were at Oakton. How did you handle it?
Well, exactly. I think when you have an experienced team, you move a little quicker and you take some things. You feel more confident throwing things at them a little bit. You also allow the kids a little bit of leeway because you know that they can accept the responsibility. Plus, they've handled you know, some tough games or big game situations. The unknown part of a young team forces you to go a little bit slower and take your time and lead them step by step a little bit to make sure that they're prepared. And you know, you go into that first Friday night and you're just, I don't know, are we going to be ready? How are we going to respond? But that's also a neat part of it. And I think in Mark's sense, I mean, he's got a very young team and I got a chance to see him scrimmage, but you know, he had the situation where he had to play a lot of kids during the two-game stretch where he had a couple kids suspended. So he had some of his JV guys. So they've actually gotten to play. The other part of that is, you know, Robinson's program has played 6 playoff games in the last 2 years, and that's 6 extra weeks of practice that those kids have gotten through that time. So they're, you know, I'm sure they're ready for their moment in the under the lights on Friday.
You always hear people say that the preparation for the next season begins the day after the last season. Is that true? Does it really work like that?
Unquestionably. You know, with as competitive as this business is and where the bar is at Robinson in particular, you know, we're the kids, the players, we're ready to go right back to work. So, you know, when we finished up there the first of December and you know, that Monday, they were chomping at the bit to get back into their off-season routine of the weightlifting and conditioning. And so, you know, we weren't going to turn them away. And I started right away reevaluating our, you know, our offense and defensive packages, our practice schedules, and, you know, looked at what worked for us and what we maybe needed to tweak. So, yeah, it's a year-round situation.
Mm-hmm. That's certainly something, you know, especially now in my position as an athletic administrator, you know, I talk to my coaches all the time, and it's not, you name the sport, it's not a 3-month job, it's a year-round job. And you know, our baseball program at Madison, which was third in the country 2 years ago, and last year we were regional champs and got beat in the state semifinals, they lifted all summer, and you know, they were encouraged to be involved in summer teams and fall teams and play other sports, but that's, you know, that it's become that type of job for most, especially if you want to be competitive, as Mark alluded to. You really have to work at it year round.
So how do you answer the critics who say, well, you're turning this into a job for these kids? Well, you know, let these kids be kids. Why do we make them do this, you know, year round?
You know, we don't make them do it year round is the operative thing. The thing I'm proudest about is most of our players, particularly our frontline players, play another sport. And you know, from following, for example, lacrosse, I think, We're very competitive in lacrosse, and I want to say we had 31 football players in the lacrosse program in the spring. Two of my coaches also work in the basketball program, so we have a lot of carryover there. We have Chase Anastasia and Olu Hall and Matt Altomare all played, all played basketball. We encourage the players, if they have the ability and interest, to go wrestle, do whatever. But we also, at the same time, will keep that weight room open till 6 in the evening if need be. So a lot of them will want to come in after their practice and get their workout in, which is helping them in their other sports too. And, if time allows in the spring, they'll get involved with the passing camp or passing league or front seven camp. We want them to experience all that high school has. The ones that want to train year-round for it, we're not going to turn them away. But, at Robinson, all the coaches in the building have a very good relationship in terms of encouraging and sharing athletes because it helps all the programs. Mm-hmm. And all my guys and my staff were multi-sport athletes, and a lot of them coach multiple sports. So it works pretty well.
And keeps them out of trouble.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Parents like it when there's structured time schedule with practices and, things of that nature.
Right. I mean, for my experience at Oakton, and you can see it across the board, the success of all the programs over there was across basketball, baseball, football. We shared athletes, and a lot of that was a group of coaches getting together and saying, okay, how do we accommodate these kids? They've got a busy schedule. Make sure that, we're not spreading them so thin or we're putting such unrealistic demands on them. That's something that I've asked the coaches at Madison to do as well. And I don't ever want the child to be caught in the middle there. The coaches need to get together and say, okay, how are we going to work this out?
All right, as we said, football gets underway this Friday night. We've got a handful of games here we want to take a look at, and we'll discuss what these guys think about these matchups. So let's go ahead and start looking at these games, picking them off one by one, all these games this Friday night. And the first one coming up here should be, the Spartans and the Wildcats. West Springfield, always kind of the bridesmaid here as of late, a program that's just inches away from breaking through maybe, and Centerville's always there.
Arguably one of the best games of the season last year, West Springfield, and that was really the game that kind of got them rolling a little bit last year. We played them right after that. Centerville, last year was the first year in 6 years, I think I found out that they didn't win a banner. They've got an experienced team coming back that were pretty young. So that'll be a great test for both teams. I think West Springfield obviously is critical for their program, and Centerville, I think, has sights on paying a few people back.
Real showcase game for running backs. Centerville has two running backs that have committed Division I scholarships, and Richard Taylor, who's going to go to Maryland, and Daniel Bailey, who's going to go to Syracuse. And then, of course, West Springfield and Derek Brazil has the leading rusher, last year's leading rusher in the region back. So two, three real strong running backs.
So two schools that are trying to make a name for themselves this year. Let's move on to our next contest, a game that'll be tugging at, Pete, your heartstrings a little bit, I imagine. The Madison Warhawks and the Oakton Cougars.
Every year that game has been just an outstanding football game. Both teams, no matter, last year we went on and played in the state finals and Madison beat us first game of the season. I expect the same kind of game. People have asked me how I feel about it. Well, obviously, I have allegiance to the old coaches at Oakton and a lot of the players that are still there, but Madison's obviously my new school. I'm sure I'll be the one guy who walks out of there happy and sad at the same time. But I think it'll be a great game. Some top flight players, Johnny Ayers from Madison, is a very, very talented three-sport athlete. They got a fine offensive line. And Oakton with Andrew Redinger, who took quite a few snaps last year at quarterback, and they also have a nice offensive line. And Quinn Cook, who you'll hear a lot about for Oakton this year. So it should be a great game, as it always is. It's the Outback Bowl.
Who's going to win?
I don't have a – I don't know. I don't coach.
Who do you want to win?
I'm glad this is the big brother asking these questions and not me. You're the only one that can get away with it.
Yeah. Okay, next game.
Right before we go to that next game, though, Mark, speak a little bit about Oakton. They had this great run last year, almost to the mountaintop. You've been there twice. You've won two state championships. What's it like coming back after a great year, trying to keep that momentum going into your first game?
Yeah, I tell you, it's not easy. You're the circled opponent. You got the target on your back. You see everybody's best game. people trying to pay you back. And it puts a real premium on preparation and having your team ready every week, because you can make or break someone's season by them, you know, by the opponent beating you. So it's, I was kidding Joe Thompson, who was the head coach now at Oakton, who was Pete's offensive coordinator. I talked to him on the phone over the summer. And
we were in South Carolina playing golf, Joe and I.
Called him on the golf course.
And Mark calls me, and he asked me a question. I said, oh, Joe's with me. And he said, let me talk to him. He goes, Joe, do you realize you're the hunted? The target is on your back.
What are you doing on a golf course in South Carolina? Probably ruined his game that day.
I was going to say, so how did he hit the ball after that?
Brought his playbook out and sat in the golf cart.
Ruined his vacation.
Okay, now let's move on to this next ball game. Westfield Bulldogs, who went through the regular season undefeated last year and who are the defending Concord champs, facing off against the Annandale Adams.
A couple of years ago, they had one of the best games in the scene in the Northern Region, about a five-time overtime situation.
68-67.
Yeah, something like 68-67. And Westfield, this is, and I think from talking to people over there, and a lot of people in the region feel that this is their year to really make a run at things. They've got several four-year starters. Their quarterback is considered the top quarterback in the state, and Sean Glennon. They have one of the most talented athletes in the Northern Region at wideout.
Eddie Royal.
Yeah, Eddie Royal, who is just, we played him in a passing league, and he is something else. And he's got his whole offense back without, you know, with the exception of the center. So they're, you know, obviously one of the teams to watch. And with, you know, Coach Adams at Annandale, he always seems to have those guys ready, and you can never count them out.
Good group of sophomores that played for Annandale last year. Anthony Morello, I believe, who was the wide receiver, will be their quarterback. They'll come to play, and Westfield's that their offense might be the greatest show on turf. So they'll be fun to watch. They really, really will be.
And I'm sure they'll be asking who let the dogs out.
Exactly.
Exactly. All right, next ball game, Langley Saxons and the Robinson Rams. Robinson, the defending district champs. And Langley coming off a 3-7 season, on paper a little bit of a mismatch, but of course you don't think so.
Well, they had a coaching change in the offseason. John Howerton, a longtime West Potomac coach, took over the program there at Langley, and I can definitely see the West Potomac influence in looking at the tape this week and getting a chance to watch them. They actually scrimmaged Oakton and came out on top on that in terms of score, you know, as much as you can figure out scrimmages. Big line up front, you know, they'll outweigh us, and I expect it to be a real battle there. They're not that complicated, but what they do very well. And last year, you may remember, they had us on the ropes in the fourth quarter, and we finally put it away 28-14, but it was a close game until about 7-8 minutes to go.
Best team in the region, right?
I didn't say that. Good words.
Yeah, okay.
If that's what you want to call them, go ahead.
Is the game going to be close?
Could be.
Paybacks, I like it. Right here on the Pendorf bench. All right, let's move on to the next contest.
You need to get back into coaching. Why don't you go over there and see if they need help?
Edison Eagles, the reigning national district champs, taking on the Chantilly Chargers. Edison, 7-0 in their district last year, and Chantilly 6-4 overall, 1-3 in their district. But word on the street is Chantilly's coming back strong this year.
Chantilly's got two of the best defensive players, Dixon and Jackson, on defense, and they'll play some offense. Chantilly should be a team to watch. You know, they were right there, lost some tough games. You know, we beat them 10-7 last year in a hard-fought game. They could have gone either way. Edison, certainly one of the class Division V teams. And the thing about Edison is they're not afraid to step up and play a Division VI game. So I'm sure that'll be a highly competitive game. Bowen Lewis, who's probably one of the deans of coaching in Northern Virginia, will have Edison ready to play. That should be a very, very interesting matchup.
All right, moving on. Let's go to Jefferson Colonials and Lake Braddock Bruins. Lake Braddock coming off a 4-6 season. Jefferson was 3-7. Lake Braddock, another team trying to get back on the back to their tradition of a winning program.
Yeah, absolutely. I think Coach Riddle has worked real hard in the offseason to get the ship righted over there. I know they went away to camp for the first time. While Coach Riddle and myself talked about some of the things that we've done. And I know he's got a tremendous offensive lineman, maybe possibly defensive lineman too, who we had a chance to see in the front seven camp, who's as good as any lineman in the region. I think he's got a fairly young team, but he feels pretty good about the group he's got. Jefferson is a tough opponent to open up with because they do so much from a formation standpoint. They're very multiple, they throw the ball. And if you don't have your defense ready, they can give you a real headache.
All right, moving on to our next contest. The Yorktown Patriots were 5-5 last year against the Northern Region Division 5 champs, the South Lake Seahawks, who finished 9-4 and 5-2 in their district.
You know, two teams, and South Lake's obviously last year regional champs, and Joe Tribuco, who's the head coach over there, has really turned that program around. I would consider them a strong contender in the Liberty District. Yorktown, perennially a national district playoff representative, if not the district champ. So possibly a playoff preview. I wouldn't be surprised if you saw both of those teams in the Division 5 playoffs. Possibly.
All right, next contest up on the slate is Falls Church Jaguars, who were 4-6 overall last year, and Marshall Statesmen, who were 1-9. Two programs just battling for respectability.
Falls Church, they obviously put together a couple of decent seasons. New coaching staff last year, and they seem to keep the momentum going there. I would see that to continue on the way that they have. JT Bittison takes over the Marshall Statesmen.
For Pete Salvano.
Yeah, and obviously Mark and I'd like to see Marshall turn around a little bit, his old alma mater. That's a traditionally good first game for both of them, and usually that'll be an indication of who's headed in the right direction.
Okay, and last game we're going to discuss here, Jeb Stuart Raiders and the Woodson Cavaliers. Cavaliers, the reigning Liberty District champs, were 9-3, 7-0 in the district, and Stuart Raiders didn't win a single ball game last year.
Yeah, on paper that one would appear to be a bit of a mismatch. Woodson really had a banner season last year, were particularly tough on defense. And Stuart struggled last year, quite frankly. Pete played Stuart and probably knows a little bit more about him. But on paper, that one looks to be a tough first game matchup for Stuart.
I mean, Woodson's program has kind of solidified itself and certainly is a contender again in the Liberty District. And they have some, excellent talent. Stuart, I haven't had a chance to see him this year, although I talked to the guys over at Oakton who actually scrimmaged him and said that, they've made a lot of progress. New coaching staff there. They have a 23-game losing streak, which is the longest in the Northern Region. Let's all hope that they can break that at some point this year, and I think they have a tough task on opening night for sure.
All right. Let's just talk. We talked a little bit about getting your team ready for the first game of the season. Let's discuss that just a little bit more. How do you get it in the right perspective that, yes, it's the beginning of the season, you want to get off to a good start, and yet you don't want to put too much pressure on that first game?
All that being said, and Pete can comment on this too, the first game is you really don't know what to expect. Oakton lost their opener last year to Madison. We were behind Langley in the fourth quarter. You really, because it's the first time with the lights on, so to speak, and when you got a lot of new players and young players, you're just not sure how they're going to respond when the stands are full. Special teams are always a question mark because it's hard to replicate and practice what you're going to get into a game, and notoriously there's issues there. I can tell you from our standpoint last year, I know exactly what the problem was. Of course, hindsight is 20/20. We had come off state championship 2001. And our players, were saying, hey, we played the Deep Creeks and the Thomas Dales. And they did not give Langley the respect they should have given Langley. And we made a tremendous amount of mistakes, a lot of penalties. And we quite frankly didn't play very well. Langley deserves a certain measure of credit. But until the fourth quarter when we finally say, hey, we might lose the game, and then all of a sudden we caught fire. But that's openers are they're kind of like homecoming games where it's, you sometimes wonder which team's going to show up. So when you pick up the paper Saturday morning, you'll see some scores that'll surprise you every year.
So depending on that outcome, win or loss, how do you then keep whatever happened Friday night in the right perspective?
Well, I think you have to look at it this way, and I think the more that you've coached – the more that you realize this, that your team makes as much progress in those first couple weeks of the season. Certainly the scrimmages are so important to get your team on tape, get them into game shape, that kind of thing. But once they sit down and they play a full game and everything counts, and you get to evaluate them, you know, teams kind of settle in 2-3 weeks into the season, and you get a real sense. You know, for example, we lost 6-3 to Madison last year, and you know, we came out of that game, and you know, it would have been easy to panic and say we're in trouble, but we knew we had a good team, and we knew that it was just a matter of time. Let's reevaluate, let's take a look at what we did wrong, and don't panic. And you know, fortunately, we were able to, you know, get it righted and headed on and had the great season that we had last year. But that's the key, is not to panic and realize that you're going to make a lot of progress at that point.
All right. Okay, we got full game action coming back this year on Channel 10 here, thanks to Fairfax Sports Network. And the games are on Saturday and Sunday. Saturday's at 5:30, Sunday's at 7. This week we're going to bring you this Madison Warhawk Oakton Cougar game that we've been discussing here tonight, so make sure to tune in for that. Also, don't forget to tune in for the Fairfax Sports Report every Thursday night at 8 o'clock, and then again Fridays at 12:30 in the afternoon. All the local scribes here that work for all these, not the Washington Post, but the guys that are actually, really right about all the action are here to talk about all that stuff. And, of course, the Bendorf Bench, we're here every Wednesday at 10 o'clock. And, yes, as I'm being reminded, we would like to thank all the sponsors who make this program possible. CCI Screen Printing, T-shirts, hats, you name it, they got it. They'll take care of you. Don't forget about Absolute Video. They're the people that are providing our mobile production truck. We'll bring you that game to you this weekend. And, of course, House of Pain. Put a little attitude into your workout, the House of Pain. And, of course, we've got a website that we want you to check out if you want to. And the address, I think, might pop up here very shortly. Maybe, maybe not.
You don't know it by heart?
I don't know it by heart. FairfaxSportsNetwork.com. Check it out for all the information about everything we do here on Channel 10. That'll do it for show number one of the 7th season of the Bendorf Bench. Join us here every Wednesday night at 10 o'clock. Until next week, go see a game. Good night.